President Biden, I want to personally thank you on behalf of the people of this great state for standing together with us here today. Before, frankly, I begin my remarks, I do want to take a moment to honor the five Marines, sir, who lost their lives Wednesday in an aircraft crash in California. Among them was a 19-year-old Lance Corporal, Mr. Evan Strickland of Valencia, New Mexico. Our deepest sympathies are with the families and the loved ones of these servicemen. As a 12th generation New Mexican, I know that our land and our people are bound together. Our families, our heritage, our future depends on how we respond to this disaster and how we act together as partners to make our people whole, protect our land, and prepare for the fires to come. As of today, 320,000 plus acres have burned since the Hermit's Peak fire started on April 6th and the Calf Canyon on April 19th. In this fire alone, we have well more than 2,500 brave men and women who are fighting this fire. Their courage, in fact, has saved many lives, many homes, and I cannot thank them enough and the other first responders for their work and their sacrifices. This is now the largest fire in our long history, and while wildfires have occurred since time immemorial, this one was not caused naturally. Now, your administration has leaned in from the very beginning, not only identifying how the fire was caused by actions by the U.S. Forest Service, but recognizing that we need to do things differently together. We are grateful for that assistance. We are grateful for the investments that you continue to make to the state to make sure that we are as safe as possible. Now, this is why I think we need the federal government to keep accepting responsibility, and I know that you have been reviewing our requests to cover 100% of the costs of the fire-related recovery efforts. We need help with debris removal, watershed protection for our rivers, streams, and acequias, the water which is the lifeblood of all but these communities in particular. Mr. President, I want to say a couple more things. It's really more than all of that work that we must do together. I don't want to lose sight of the fact that 1,200 homes were burned, hundreds of thousands of acres of farm and grazing land destroyed, and many family businesses lost. It's about the blood and sweat of generations of New Mexicans who worked the land, who fed their families, and they raised their children there. All of that just went up in smoke. It's the thousands who were forced to evacuate, not knowing what they would find when they returned, and it is now the mental scars this fire has left on our children. Earlier this week, I met with Jerry Gomez at the burned-out ruins of his home in a little place called Rosiada. Jerry built his home 36 years ago on land that has been in his family longer than New Mexico has been a state. He's now faced with finding pasture for his cattle, saving his construction business, and keeping his family and property safe when the monsoons come. Now, despite the devastation and pain and heartbreak, Jerry told me that he will rebuild. That's who we are, Mr. President. We are strong and resilient. We know we are faced with disasters unlike anything we've seen in generations past. Larger fires, stronger and more frequent hurricanes, and flooding on a scale never seen before. I was born in Los Alamos. In May of 2000, the Cerro Grande fire tore through the town, causing over $1 billion in damages and threatened our national lab. It, like this fire, was caused by a controlled burn. 22 years later, we're here again. That's why I'm so grateful at your work and the work of the USDA to be willing to change the policies of the last century to reflect the dangers of the 21st century. We cannot afford to merely hope for a better future. We have to act and make it the future that each and every one of us deserves. We will rebuild our homes, our communities, and restore our land, Mr. President. That's what we do. Now, it's the duty of the federal government and the state to do right by the people of New Mexico. And as governor, I so look forward to joining you and the congressional delegation to make New Mexico and its people whole. And with that, Mr. President, it is an incredible honor to again thank you for being here and to ask you to lead us with remarks.
Well, Governor, thank you very much. Before I begin, we're on National Guard property. I just want to say that National Guard obviously is controlled by the governor, except when federalized. And I have federalized you a number of times nationwide to fight fires, to fight every disaster we've had. And my son was a major in the National Guard, and I think the people don't quite understand the extent of the work you do and the risk you take for us. And secondly, there's an expression where I come from. God made man, then he made some firefighters. You're all crazy, but I love you. I grew up in a neighborhood called Claymont, Delaware, when we moved from Scranton when coal died. And although my parents weren't in the coal mines, they were in sales, but the economy shriveled. And we moved down to this little steel town. And I went to a little Catholic school across from the fire department, the fire station. And everybody I grew up with either became a cop, a firefighter, or a priest. I wasn't qualified for any of them, so here I am. just so you know, I've done too many individual and mass funerals for firefighters and the hot shots and the incredible group of people. I mean, a truly incredible group of people. Anybody, the overwhelming human instinct is you run away from a fire, not into it. And the only thing that protects firefighters is more firefighters. The only thing, more firefighters. And I just wanted to say that at the outset because you have my indebted gratitude. And my fire department saved my life, literally, not figuratively. My house got struck by lightning and mostly burned down, had to be rebuilt. Saved, the smoke was so thick, Gov, it was literally that thick. And you couldn't see through the windows or out the windows. And the floors were collapsing. These guys went in and did two things. Mostly importantly, got my wife out. I was in Washington when it happened and saved our cat. But equally important, almost not equally, but important, I have a 67 Corvette they got out. And so anyway, but my point is you're incredible. And so, Governor, thank you. And Senators Heinrich and Lujan, thank you very much for all you do. And Teresa Lezar Fernandez and, Harrell and Stansberry and all members of the House doing a great job. And but maybe the proudest thing I've done is I appointed the first Native American to be a cabinet member. But she's only been in New Mexico 35 generations. You're a newcomer. Newcomer. But look, a special thanks again to the firefighters. Over 4,000 of you. Over 4,000 of you putting your lives on the line. And we're about to receive a briefing about the largest, most destructive wildfire in America so far this year. And the largest wildfire in New Mexico's history. I just flew over some of the damage, and Air Force One is so damn big we couldn't go in. But we flew the perimeter of the fire, and it's an astounding amount of territory. And the impact on families that have been there for so long are so consequential. And in a way, there's nearly 700,000 acres. And a new fire just started, have just started. Thousands of people displaced, ranchers wiped out, schools shuttered, and a wilderness that looks like a moonscape, if you see parts of it where I was able to see. And I'm thinking about what you're thinking, and that is our responsibility. It's not a gift. We have a responsibility to help this state recover, to help the families who have been here for centuries, and the beautiful northern New Mexico villages who can't go home and whose livelihoods have been fundamentally changed. Governor, let me be clear. We will be here for you in response and recovery for as long as it takes. As long as it takes. And I learned something about this governor. When she asked something, I just said yes. But I don't think there's
a legislature to do that.
Well, that's what we're trying. I've publicly gone on record as supporting it. I'm supporting it. That is 100%. Anyway, I hope we're able to get that done. I know that Ben Ray is working like hell in the House to get passage, but we're going to have a little more trouble in the United States Senate. We have 50 Democratic senators, which means we have 51 presidents. So it's, you know, we got to get a consensus, and we can't not a consensus in some cases if they insist on it being a requiring cloture. We need 60 votes, so it remains to be seen. And so, when you asked for the major disaster declaration, Governor, I immediately responded, providing millions of dollars in housing assistance and cash grants and funding for emergency responders. Not because of doing any favor, it's an obligation. I think we have a responsibility as a government to deal with the communities who are put in such jeopardy. And today I'm announcing the federal government is covering 100% of the cost of the green removal and emergency protective measures for the next critical months in this recovery. And then there's going to be a strong bridge until we pass the Hermit's Peak Fire Assistance Act, introduced by Senator Lujan and Senator Heinrich and Senator Fernandez, as well as Stansberry, to fully compensate survivors for their total loss. We're also providing funding and loans for small businesses, farmers, and ranchers. And we need to be sure this doesn't happen again. We know the circumstances of Hermit's Park and Cafe Canyon fires are unique, starting with a prescribed burn. Every year, the Forest Service, to put this in perspective, they do a pretty damn good job, conduct 4,500 prescribed burns. 99.8% go as planned. But this time, tragically, it did not. And that's why the Forest Service has just put a complete pause on prescribed burns in the Forest Service lands, and it's conducting an intensive 90-day review, which will make public all the detail of that review. And this needs to happen, and I'll be briefed on the results, and we'll brief the world on the results, the country on the results. And for folks at home, there are hundreds of federal personnel on the ground trying to help you get through this. I think if you take a look, the most important thing you can do is register with FEMA, which allows you to get assistance you deserve and you need quickly. And there's a FEMA mobile app that allows you to quickly register for assistance, and it's available in Spanish as well. And our director of FEMA, who I think has done an incredible job, how many folks you have here now, roughly?
Just under 400.
Just under 400 here, and it's... if you don't have phone service yet, you have disaster recovery centers in Mora and Las Vegas where you can register as well. And we also have a team on the ground to help you register. And FEMA is calling every person who is denied assistance, anybody denied assistance, to ensure they get the help they need and in the language they speak. A lot of, you got to know how to know. You got to know what you need to know to be able to get something done. I can walk into the Library of Congress, one of the great libraries in the world. You don't know how to work the card catalog, it's not very much use to you. I mean it. You got to know how to know. And so we've learned in our administration, it's not just enough to provide the help, but let people know how they can access the help, and when they can't, how they can go about to fix that. And so eligible residents can sign up for a state program that provides benefits to buy groceries and hot meals as well. For the longer term, but beginning right now, we have to help with the combined impacts of drought and wildfires and which threaten your vital watershed. And it's hard to explain to people back east when I talk about this, because we've spent some time, the FEMA director and I, in other parts of the country, in Northern California, Oregon, up in Idaho, to explain what we're talking about, the scope and size and the consequence, and how the watershed is not literally, but in fact, evaporating in many places, find yourself in a position where it has vital impact. And through the bipartisan infrastructure, we've already invested hundreds of millions of dollars in the state of your drought relief and wildfire mitigation and water infrastructure. And as the monsoon season approaches, we've authorized another $22 million to protect critical water infrastructure from post-fire flooding. Post-fire flooding debris flows, and the work starts today. Starts today, not next week, not next month, today. The bottom line is, Gov, to the people in New Mexico, we'll do whatever it takes, as long as it takes, to follow your leadership and tell us what you need, and I promise you. We kind of joke. They said the governor's on the phone. I said, just tell her yes, and then I start the conversation. Y'all think I'm kidding. I'm not kidding. I'm going to stop here, and I guess we're going to start the briefing if we could. But I guess, David, I'm talking to you first. You're Secretary of Department of Homeland Security and Emergency Management, so I'm going to yield to you, okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you for joining us today. We are grateful for the federal government's support of state and local efforts throughout this crisis, but more help is needed. As the fires have grown since early April, we focused on the immediate shelter needs of the families. Since then, we have stood up 10 shelters around the state and housed nearly 1,000 evacuees. The state partnered with community organizations to provide many services for the evacuees, including meals, medical treatment, behavioral and mental health, transportation, child necessities, pet and livestock needs, and donation management. As firefighters have made progress, we have now fewer than 180 evacuees staying in hotels. As we transition our focus to the recovery, I cannot overstate the dire situation developing in the affected areas and the fact that we do not have the resources we need to help all those who have been impacted. Our primary focus is continuing to provide services for affected and displaced families, as well as thoroughly planned long-term solutions to rebuild what was lost by so many. On this task especially, we eagerly accept the federal government's increased assistance and partnership. Monsoon rains predicted this summer pose a severe hazard to the burned areas, and based on early assessments from our surveillance teams, the threat from flash floods and debris to downstream communities is great and will remain so for years to come. What's more, damage to our watersheds will take decades to repair. Climate change, prolonged drought, and the use of valuable water for firefighting is already creating shortages for communities across New Mexico, and three counties currently require emergency water delivery. New Mexico has experienced devastating fire damage across nearly 1 million acres of forest and grassland this year alone. And just yesterday, there were two significant new fires in the state. State and local teams are working tirelessly to support and protect New Mexicans whose lives have been forever changed by these fires, but more help is needed. We need hydrologists and meteorologists to assist with predicting weather and the potential impacts. We need emergency management specialists and floodplain experts to augment small communities that lack the staffing to effectively execute these recovery plans. Our citizens are tired, angry, and afraid of the future that awaits them. Federal dollars supporting federal, state, tribal, and local teams on the ground is the only way we will effectively mitigate the dangers that confront us. Long-term recovery will include every aspect of the state government, from economic development and workforce solutions to education and healthcare. With the full support of the federal government, we will overcome these emerging catastrophes to help and protect thousands of affected New Mexicans. It is our solemn duty. Thank you, Mr. President.